One day a lawyer told an attorney friend of his, "You know what? I'm going to start teaching Sunday school." And his attorney friend said, "You don't know enough Bible to teach Sunday school." He said, "I sure do." He said, "You don't even know the Lord's Prayer." He said, "I do." He said, "Now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And if I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." His attorney friend said, "You win. I didn't know you knew so much Bible." Honestly, we don't want to be that guilty of not knowing Bible. We want to read it, we want to study it, we want to memorize it, so that if our turn ever comes to do something like that for the Lord, we'll know enough Bible to be able to do it. Listen, when Jesus was tempted by the devil in the wilderness, you know what he did? He quoted Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 3, and he used it as a defense. He said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." And if you are ever going to live by the words of God, then you're going to have to be in your Bible. You're going to have to read it. You're going to have to study it, and you're going to have to memorize it. So let's talk about that today in this discipleship lesson. Let's first of all talk about reading the Bible. We're told specifically in Isaiah chapter 34, verse 16, "Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read." What could be clearer? Now, the way to do this is simple. Pick up a Bible, turn to Genesis, and read all the way to the book of Revelation. When you get to the end of the Bible, go back to Genesis and start over and read it again and again and again. I have a friend of mine who was saved, and he had been raised a Roman Catholic, so he hadn't been reading his Bible. But you know what? When he got saved, he started reading the Bible right away, and he said, "I've been reading my King James Bible every day. I read it twice through every year." There was a Wycliffe translator down in the Philippines. His name was Dick Elkins, and he had his first convert, who was a friend of his named Sibilian. And what happened is that Dick's four-year-old son got sick, and he was going to need surgery 3 months later. So Dick told Sibilian, "Hey, we've got to get on the translation of the book of Mark, and we've got to do it now." Well, Sibilian said, "I can't. I've planted my crops. I've got to build a fence to protect those crops from hogs. And, you know, if I stay here to translate this, my crop is going to be destroyed." So he left. But a few days later, Sibilian returned. And Dick said, "Did you already finish the fence?" And he said, "No." He said, "Every time I was driving a fence post into the ground, I got to thinking about the Gospel of Mark." And he said, "I just couldn't do it." And, you know, working together, they were able to finish that translation before the three-month deadline, which was a great thing in itself. And then Sibilian went back to his farm, and when he did, sure enough, it had been destroyed by hogs. That he only got 3 sacks of rice for his whole production. And somebody said, "You must really be upset." And he said, "No, I'm not. In my rice farming, all I could have done is come up with some carnal food to feed the body. But instead, I worked with the man of God and produced the Word of God, which feeds souls. That is more important." And they said, "Why?" He said, "Because man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." So that's why Sibilian did that. He wanted to feed somebody spiritually. Now, Jesus Christ, when he was here, is the Word of God incarnate. And you know what? When he ministered on earth, he was able to confound the Jews out of the law, not because he was the Word of God incarnate, but because he was in the book. And it wasn't because he was formally educated. In John chapter 7, verses 15 and 16, the Jews marvel, saying, "How knoweth this man letters, having never learned?" Jesus answered them and said, "My doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me." See, he wasn't formally educated, but he was in the Bible. He was in the Word of God. He was able to confound them because he received the written words of God under the instruction of his Father. In Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4, you know what he said? "The Lord God hath given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth morning by morning. He wakeneth my ear to hear as the learned." And the Lord can do the same thing for you. Each day, Jesus was instructed in the words of God. So, when he had a chance to preach in the synagogue one day in Luke chapter 4, verse 17, he knew right where to turn in the book of Isaiah for his sermon, and he knew exactly how to apply the prophecy that he was reading. And mind you, there were no chapter numbers, there were no verse numbers, there were nothing to mark the scriptures. He just knew where it was because he knew it very well. When he rebuked the Pharisees, you know what he said their problem was? He said, "Have you not read?" And that was their problem. The failure to read and believe the scriptures. You don't want that to be your problem. You need to read. There's a parable about a man in a desert that was instructed to pick up some stones. And he said, when you do, you're going to be both sad and you're going to be happy. So the man did as he was told. He picked up a few stones, put them in his pocket. And the next day, he reached in his pocket. And when he did, he had diamonds and emeralds and rubies. You know what? The voice of the prophecy that he had heard was right. He was happy because he had all these precious stones. He was sad because he didn't take more. That's exactly how your Bible reading is. If you read just a little bit, you'll be happy that you did, but there'll be a day when you look back and you'll say, man, I wish that I had read more. So read plenty of Bible. But that's not all. Not only do you need to read the Bible, you also need to study the Bible. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, we are commanded by the Word of God to study the Bible. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And studying is a lot different than reading, in that it involves searching the Scripture. I mean, where you go through and actually really dig it out and cross-reference it and pull it out. In John chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus said, search the Scriptures. For in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. When Paul preached to the Bereans in Acts chapter 17, the Bible says, these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the Scriptures daily, whether those things were so. So basically, what you should do is you should compare those scriptures that are alike. You should contrast those scriptures that are different. You ought to check the cross references that are in the Bible. Look up the definitions to words and believe what you are reading and studying. You don't have to be a scholar to do this. You just have to be a regular student of the Bible. A preacher used to go to an old uneducated cobbler with questions about the Bible when he was studying. If he ran into something he didn't understand, he'd go and ask this cobbler. This cobbler was an uneducated man. He wasn't a scholar, but he studied his Bible and he knew it very well. And he was bragging on this cobbler to another preacher friend of his who was a little young and cocky and pretty smart. And the young cocky preacher said, I would like to meet the old cobbler and ask him a question. I bet I could stump him. So they went and talked to the cobbler, and the young preacher said, what's the Urim and Thummim? And the old cobbler kind of rubbed his whiskers, and he said, well, he said, I don't really know. There's something in the Old Testament used by the priest to inquire of the Lord. They mean lights and perfections, and somehow God gave an answer to reveal his mind through the breastplate whenever they inquired. But he said, you know something? After thinking about those two words, I realized I could change two letters in Urim and Thummim and come up with the mind of the Lord just like those old priests did. It's not the Urim for me, it's using. And it's not the Thummim for me, it's thumbing. And when I'm using and thumbing in my Bible, I can get the mind of the Lord that way. Study the Bible. Well, you ought to read it. You ought to study it, and then you ought to memorize it. Memorizing the Bible is a matter of going over the Scripture again and again and again until you get it down in your heart where you cannot forget it. I'm going to give you some references in the Bible that show you you need to hide God's words in your heart. Deuteronomy 6:6, for instance. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Deuteronomy 11:18. Therefore shall ye lay up these words in your heart and in your soul and bind them for a sign upon your hand that they may be as frontlets between your eyes. Psalm 37:31. The law of his God is in his heart. None of his steps shall slide. Psalm 119 verse 11. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Now the way we hide God's words in our hearts is by memorizing them. And to memorize them, you just go over them. For instance, one day you could go over a verse 25 times, the next day 20, the next day 15, the next day 10, the next day 5. And you know what? By the time you've done that, you will have the verses memorized. Pastor David Hollowick said it this way. Many believers remain weak because they fail to store up in their minds helpful passages from the Word of God. Apparently, they don't realize that in times of stress, sorrow, or temptation, the Holy Spirit can bring those portions to their remembrance to comfort them, to warn them, and to direct them. You know what? The followers of some pagan religions are often required to saturate their minds with their sacred writings. For instance, no one can teach in a Mohammedan mosque until he has first memorized the Quran. One missionary tells that 21 hours she listened to a group of Buddhist priests quoting their devotional literature from memory, and seldom, if ever, did they ever make a mistake. Michael Billister once gave a Bible to a humble villager in an eastern Poland village and then left. He returned a few years later just to see how the fellow was doing, and you know what? There were 200 people that had become believers through using that Bible. And when the group was gathered together to hear Billister preach, you know what he said? He said, before I preach, why doesn't somebody here quote a verse of Scripture? And a fellow jumped up and he said, did you say a verse of Scripture or a chapter of Scripture? And Billister said, what, are you kidding me? There are people here that can quote chapters of Scripture? And that local man that had received that Bible said, you know, there are 13 here that know half of the book of Genesis. They know the books of Matthew and Luke. And another one has committed all the Psalms to memory. Combined, the 200 believers knew virtually the entire Bible. You know what? You need to constantly hide the words of God in your heart. Are you doing that? If not, then you need to begin today. Because when you read the Bible, when you study the Bible, and when you memorize the words of God, then you're going to be able to do what we are instructed to do in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11. You will be able to answer as the oracles of God. And may God bless you when you do.